I'd like to discuss the semiconductor laser, arguably one of the greatest technological developments in our lifetime. The semiconductor laser was invented in the 1960s. In 1960, there was the first demonstration of the Ruby and the Heaney lasers, but the semiconductor laser was not far behind. In 1962, there were three groups that demonstrated the first semiconductor laser. These included GE, Lincoln Laboratory, and IBM. Progress followed rapidly. By 1969, the first heterostructured laser, made out of several materials, was demonstrated at room temperature pulsed with a threshold current of 5 kiloamps per centimeter squared. By the 1970s, 0.8 and 0.9 micron semiconductor lasers were being deployed in the first generation communication systems. And by 1975, there'd been a 10x improvement in the threshold current density for heterostructured lasers, bringing the current density down to 0.5 kiloamps per centimeter squared. This meant that the technology was really useful and could be applied in many arenas. So now let's talk about the mechanisms for the semiconductor laser and how it compares with other types of lasers. So just as in other types of lasers, it's highly monochromatic, it's coherent, and it's directional. But it operates on a different set of transition. So the laser transitions are between bands versus discrete energy levels. And if we look at the density of states near the band edges, we find that it's between 10 to the 19 and 10 to the 20 per centimeter cubed. This is 9 to 10 orders of magnitude larger than the density of states we find in a gas laser. And so the consequence is that semiconductor lasers have high gain coefficients and short cavities, and it's efficient to modulate them, and they can be modulated very quickly. So let's talk more about the semiconductor laser. By tuning the material, i.e. the band gap energy, we can engineer the spatial and the spectral properties easily. Secondly, by directly injecting holes and electrons into the active region via current, we can produce laser action. So this means the semiconductor lasers are electrically pumped. Thirdly, the laser transition has a very short lifetime, and what that means is it's possible to modulate these devices quickly. So what you're looking at here is you're looking at a representative sampling of the different types of semiconductor lasers. So basically, I've showed you different materials versus wavelengths. So this chart is going from 0.2 to 5 microns. And so what you can see is that for the short band gap materials, we need to use nitrides. For medium gap materials, we can use things like aluminum gallium arsenide. As we go longer into the telecom wavelengths, we need to use indium gallium arsenide or indium gallium arsenide phosphide. And as we push longer, we really need to use antimonides that have small band gaps. Semiconductor lasers are really dictated by lattice matching. And so what I mean here is that they are based on having radiative transitions where you have an electron and a hole that recombine and emit a photon. This is predicated on having high quality material. So what you see on this chart, this is band gap energy versus lattice constant. And so in order to demonstrate a high quality semiconductor laser, we need to grow lattice matched materials. And so what does that mean? That basically limits the type of compounds we can use, and it also limits what substrates we can grow on. So you can see that if we stay on these vertical lines, then essentially we can grow lattice matched material. So this chart really sets the space for what we can do in order to get high quality material that's capable of lasing transitions. The last point I'd like to make is basically to go back to optical fiber, because this is one of the driving applications for semiconductor lasers. What you're looking at here is you're looking at a plot of the loss versus wavelength. You can see that at 1.55 microns, the loss is lowest. This is actually where the current fiber communication systems operate. You can see at 1.3 microns, the loss is pretty low. But initially, communication systems were made at 0.9 microns, where the loss is still reasonable.